me. I just try to see if I had some coffee on my teeth. How you doing, Pat?
I'm doing okay, thanks, Beth.
My internet keeps going in and out. I guess I better go ahead and mute.
Good morning and welcome to this service of worship here at Parkway United Church of Christ, where through God's Spirit we seek to listen deeply, build community, and act for justice. Happy Father's Day to all those who offer parenting, presence, and love in the world. We know that this land we call Winston-Salem is the rightful home of Cherokee, Saponi, Tutelo, Soxipaha, and Socorri nations, a land stolen from these nations. So we commit to recognizing and repairing the harm that colonization has caused to the land, to these indigenous people, and all who brought to this continent for enslavement. Whether this is your first time with us or your 200th time, you are welcome here. Whether you're on Zoom or Facebook Live or in the sanctuary,
you are welcome here.
Whether you have been out and about outside this morning or just waking up, you are welcome here. No matter your sexual orientation, gender identity or expression, racial, ethnic background, you are welcome here. Whether you've got a dime in your bank account or not, you are welcome here. No matter who you are, where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. We are grateful to Anna, our pianist and choir director, and she has prepared a prelude for us.
Thank you.
Friends, we worship more with more than our heads and our voices. We worship with our entire bodies. We know that touching solar plexus or abdominal region has particular access to the soul nerve, the nerve that connects across our bodies. So I invite you, as we seek to harmonize our bodies in worship, to gently rub your solar plexus or your abdomen in a way that may feel soothing to you. And if it doesn't, of course, do something else. And breathe in and out. All of our worship is Eucharistic in giving thanks. And so we begin our worship on this summer series with the blessing of cup and bread. Father, we give you thanks for the holy vine of your servant David, which you made known to us through Jesus, your servant. Mother of us all, we give thanks for the life and the knowledge you sent us through Jesus, your child.
Glory to you forever and ever.
As grain was scattered across the hills, then gathered and made one in bread, so may your church, scattered to the ends of the earth, be gathered and made one in your commonwealth. Our hymn to open this morning is Rock of Ages, number 10 in the New Century Hymnal, Rise in Body and or Spirit. Seated. Last week we honored in particular those who are in our community 85 years of age or older, and we have at least one person in that category who's able to join us today, and that is Henrietta Fulton. So we give thanks and praise for your service, your ministry, your presence in this congregation. We gave opportunity, Henrietta, for others last week to share, if they'd like, a word for the congregation. Would you like to share a word?
This has always been a different kind of congregation Go for it. Keep it up.
Beautiful. Pat said last week, she told me today, I had something to say, but I think it was going to take a long time. And what she said is when she came here from Minnesota, somebody gave her a no box that had all kinds of reasons that you might say no. All of the needlepoint projects, not enough time, et cetera, et cetera. Her daughter said oftentimes, particularly in the context of jobs here at Parkway, that she got out her no box after she had already said yes. We remember Peggy T as she's come home from the hospital. Pauline J, who's had some real health challenges. Bill, Deborah, Stephanie. We delight in Thanksgiving with Janice and Sean, the birth of their granddaughter. We are grateful for Faith being with us in worship today as she continues to grieve in the wake of Ralph's death. We are delighted with China, who has now gotten a job as a chaplain with hospice in Hickory, North Carolina. We remember Ken R., who had some surgery this past week and is recovering at home. We pray with Pat S. as she continues to deal with medical news. We pray with the Southern Conference of the United Church of Christ as representatives from each congregation gather in Greensboro this coming weekend. I'm going to invite those on Zoom to place in the chat what it is you have on your hearts and minds, and also those in the sanctuary to briefly share what you wish. Yeah, Lisa. For the United Methodist Church Conference who gathered this weekend. Craig. I missed that, Craig. Happy Father's Day to everyone. Others. Yes, Kate. Andrea is getting settled in Florida, including finding a UCC congregation. Birthday greetings to Sterling. Yes, Leslie. For everyone, particularly Evan, who are experiencing gender transitioning and all that means. I'm going to read deep prayers for Carolyn and Paul as Carolyn is recovering from surgery and doing rehab. Bill, prayers for our LGBT friends who remain in the crosshairs of so many legislators and intolerant citizens. From Diane, prayers for our friend Pat S. Good to see her on Zoom. Are there others?
Great. I'd like to celebrate just having a great visit with my
for John's family, especially his son David, as they travel to be with John's brother and family. Yes. For Brother Rick and his spouse, who is actively dying. Invite us into a time of stillness. There's so many other things that we are carrying that have not been articulated, but we have opportunity to hold those before sacred presence. And then we'll move into a time of praying the prayer Jesus taught in the language and tradition of your choice. Our Father, Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sin as we forget those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and glory forever. Amen. I invite you to share a sign of peace with one another.
Peace.
Peace.
Hey, Sarah Lou.
Hi, everybody. Hey, Pat. Peace. Good to see you on there.
Yes, thank it you. Is. It's good to see
hey,
you.
Diane. Hey, Diane. Nice to
hey.
See you.
Hey, Bill.
Jeff. Mary.
Hey, Sarah Lou. Nice to see you.
Yes,
it is. Sarah keeps skipping out a little bit. Apparently, my internet connection is unstable, it says. So if I leave, it's not by my.
I understand.
Sure. Pat, how are you?
I'm doing okay.
Good. It's good to see you today.
Thank you.
And Bill, how's it going?
You give a thumbs up. I think we can go now.
Working on a plan. Thanks for asking, Diane.
All right. Glad to hear that. And so good to see Deborah too.
She's got one she's working on as well.
Yeah.
I know. You guys are strong people.
Well, and we got a big calendar.
Oops, I think I heard that special little. Yep, I heard it.
Yep, see you later.
How's that? Can you all hear me? There we go. Put it down a little more. I think it's picking me up. Okay, well, that didn't work very well. How about now? Our sacred text today, the first one, comes from Genesis 18. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre as he sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day. He looked up and saw three men standing near him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent entrance to meet them and bowed down to the ground. He said, "My Lord, if I find favor with you, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought, and wash your feet, and rest yourselves under the tree. Let me bring a little bread, that you may refresh yourselves, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant. So they said, do as you have said. And Abraham hastened into the tent to Sarah and said, make ready quickly 3 measures of choice flour, knead it, and make cakes. Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set it before them, and he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, where is your wife Sarah? And he said, there in the tent. Then one said, I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife Sarah shall have a son. And Sarah was listening at the tent entrance behind him. Now Sarah and Abraham were old, advanced in age. It had ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. So Sarah laughed to herself, saying, after I have grown old and my husband is old, shall I be fruitful? The Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh and say, shall I indeed bear a child now that I am old? Is anything too wonderful for the Lord? At the set time, I will return to you in due season, and Sarah shall have a son. But Sarah denied, saying, I did not laugh, for she was afraid. He said, yes, you did laugh. And then from Hebrews 13, let mutual affection continue. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing that, some have entertained angels without knowing it.
With us.
Thank you.
guess, when whether you punctuate the two and the four or the one and the three, all of us together celebrate this weekend of marking emancipation of human lives. Since I laid my burden down. You know, I was recognizing when Beth was reading that text, for all the foodies out there, there is a Hebrew word for choice flour that is designated for the kind of special flour that only monarchs use to have their bread baked for them. That's the kind of hospitality we're talking about. When we were growing up, my father would use a well-known grace when we sat at the table to eat supper. Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest, is how it began. And when you think about it, that's a rather bold petition, isn't it? Amen. We prepared, what, the chop suey or freshly sliced tomatoes from the garden and grilled cheese sandwiches. And we were asking you, Sacred Mystery, to be our guest, to be party to our mundane chatter of our daily routine, to be a part of the sibling squabbles and who was going to wash the dishes after. Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest. What a thing to ask the Spirit of Mystery to do, to risk taking sustenance at our table, to take the time and the energy to immerse in utterly unremarkable conversation, to witness our imperfection and sometimes our dysfunction. Wow, Jesus, come be our guest. Really, every time we sit down at the table, at least in some indirect way, we are not just asking for anything. We are asking for this particular thing, for sacred presence to be hosted by us, to come with presence to shape our digestion, to companion our ingestion of the goods of the earth, to color our conversation, our way of being, to move our eating from just scarfing something down to actually being a sacred practice. Abraham is sitting in the heat of the day trying to recover from just at the age of 99 having his foreskin cut off to fulfill a promise of God. And then we know in the passage that the three strangers are coming from a distance, and he runs out to meet them, to coax them into the shade of the terebinth at the very place where earlier in the story he has created an altar. He undersells, though, when they approach. He says, we'll throw together some leftovers and get you some water. And then sets in motion all of the things that he asks his household to do, to kill a calf and prepare it, to make cakes of this fine flour, to create cheese for the guests. Imagine the time that it would take to butcher an animal, to make the bread, to let the curd set, all while Abraham is standing there under the tent, sweating away, grimacing at every twitch, trying to keep their water glasses full. Come, God, be our guest, and let this encounter to us be blessed. You see, Abraham and Sarah aren't given the word in the end of this story that they are going to have a son, Isaac, because of their extravagant hospitality. They offer this extravagant hospitality because they are already told that they are a blessing, that they will have presence on a journey, that their life has meaning. And still they doubt and they laugh at the ridiculousness of the possibility. Everything in the middle of this story becomes rather murky, doesn't it? Are these three visitors, or is this God? Whom is it that this family is actually serving this feast? Strangers become messengers of God's presence, and maybe even God's presence itself. Whom do we serve when we host at table, when we break bread with others? We may be just entertaining angels unawares. While all at the same time we're worried about the health report, discerning which bill to pay, thinking about scraping up the dishes and making sure the water glasses are filled, over the course of these biblical narratives, over the course of human interaction, Holy Presence becomes incarnate at the table when people sacrifice life to eat, when people gather to have something to share. In the short essay that we distributed for today, inviting people to read, by Leonardo Boff, one of the architects of liberation theology, he writes that archaeologists, paleontologists, know that even the earliest of humans would go out and hunt and gather, and they would not eat alone. They would gather these things back, and they would share them together in community. It's a distinguishing mark of humanness. The table becomes the altar not only of sacrifice, but also of making meaning of what it means to be human. Walter Brueggemann talks about what it means to make covenant, and that is shot through all of these stories in Genesis. What Sarah and Abraham had been doing again and again with God. And how do you cut a covenant? The instruction is pretty clear in Genesis 15. You take an animal and you hack it in half, and you separate the two parts, and then you walk through the middle of those two parts. And that even holy presence, symbolized by fire and smoke, also passes through the two parts of the animal in this vulnerable act of passing through, if you will, the valley of death. God risks God's identity and God's future to claim a bond with human parties. God says, I'm going to go out of my way to be in love with you. When you think about it, every time we share bread, God is renewing that promise with us. I'm willing to be hosted by you. I'm willing to risk everything so that you might have life, you might have a future, you might have relationship. I go out of my way so as to be in love with you. Whether that's over rice and beans or grilled salmon on cedar planks, come, Lord Jesus, be our guest. Let this food to us be blessed. When Sarah and Abraham encounter this news, Sarah laughs. Abraham stands in stone silence at the prospect of having a son. And then the voice of the visitors, or the voice of Adonai, does not state, but asks the question, is anything too extraordinary for God? Is anything too extraordinary for God? Abraham and Sarah are not, in this passage in particular, exemplars of faithfulness. They are examples of what might just happen when you're full of doubt. You can slaughter the calf, you can say your prayers, you can serve on church council, you can clean up and wash out all of the communion cups after worship, you can show up early to pass out the bulletin, you can sing in the choir, you can serve at City with Dwellings, and you can still be what? Full of doubt. So the holy visitors come inside our derisive chuckles and our waving of a hand at the possibility of something impossible, and ask us point blank, is anything too exceptional for Holy Presence? Really, whenever we sit at table, we are confronted with a hard question that is difficult to ignore. Is anything too exceptional for the sacred? When one seed becomes a thousand, crooked neck, somber squash on countless tables across the city, when the lines of amino acids and minerals give us exactly the energy we need to live another day, when the microorganisms in the soil are exactly doing the thing that allows our guts to thrive so that we can think and walk and talk and reach out to one another with care. When the water from the clouds gives us the clear miracle needed for ourselves to exchange information, when one conversation, when one shared laugh, when one good story breaks us open to the wonder of community, are we not confronted with the question, is anything too exceptional for God? People often ask me, well, what was the moment? What was the exact time in your life when you felt called to serve the church? And I say, I can't point to any particular time. It was so subtle, experience by experience, more likely experiences of being so tired from running from the prospect that I gave up. But there is one story that does stand out a little bit, and it happened to be at table. I'd renovated a shotgun shack in the Mississippi Delta of Missouri. I was growing my own garden in the backyard. I started a food pantry out of my little living room there. One night I was preparing the food that I had picked from the garden that afternoon, and I was sitting at the card table to eat my supper. And there was this strange voice that told me, set another place setting. It was odd because I lived alone. So I got out the only other knife, fork, spoon, cup, plate. I think I even put a napkin there. And as I sat and I ate my limas and my blueberries and my squash and the bread, there was this incredibly strong sense of companionship at the table that came over me. I was absolutely convinced that the prayer of our childhood table was utterly true. Jesus was palpably present as my guest, as if to ask in the center of my curiosity, is anything too wonderful for God? Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest.
Thank you.
I'm just going to do this time to avoid knocking that off. We have been truly blessed by all the gifts shared here this morning, from Grant and Anna and the music and this lovely display of hospitality pieces that Lisa Wishon put together, by your presence here. In addition to those things, to worship in this space and to do God's work in the world, we need some money. We do a lot with what we have, but we do need some. There are several ways you can give to the church's work if you wish. There's an offering plate at the back. You can drop a check in there. You can go online and use a credit card to make a gift that way, and you can also mail things to the church, mail checks to the church. So please give as you are able. Thank you.
Thank you, Beth. After church, there's a time of community with snacks. And Judy tells me, where's Judy? Talk to Judy. If you did not sign up for the table talk and still would like to come, because she's got some seats still available. Have you filled out the congregational assessment? There are hard copies available right out here. There's a way to link in on our announcements and our bulletin. This is the last week. We are hoping for a few more responses before we start collating them. Strengthen the Church is a special offering of the United Church of Christ to do innovative incarnational things in community. And so we are continuing to receive your prayerful offerings to that special offering this month of June. This Wednesday, 6:15, out here, we are going to be celebrating summer solstice. There'll be a time of just silent encountering with the natural world. We'll have a chance to eat something together. Hope you can come out. We are still looking for somebody who could offer the welcome drum to welcome people to the space as we gather. So if that's a call to you, let me know. Next Sunday, we are invited after church to join for lunch. An organization who is seeking a relationship with us called the Wild Ones, who are committed to planting native species in landscapes. And so there's an opportunity to sign up this week if you'd like to join them for lunch. We're so grateful for that invitation. This Saturday, we're going to gather, those of us who can, for the Pride Parade downtown, 9:45 on 4th Street between Spring and Poplar. Bring your t-shirt if you've got it. We'll have extra Parkway t-shirts. Bring water, sunscreen, a hat. We're going to distribute stickers like we always do. The parade begins at 11. Michael is signing people up who are planning on participating so that we know who to contact as we continue to prepare for our presence there. And then I'm going to call on Steve Boyd to give us an invitation.
So some of you may have been here back in March, I think it was, when I gave a presentation on Oak Flat, trying to protect the sacred site that an international mining company is trying to destroy. And that tribe and the Apache stronghold have been working on this for like 15 years. And there's been some good news recently, and that is that in the 9th District, the Apache stronghold, our friend Winsler Nosey, who has been here, filed a lawsuit, and a three-panel of judges, they were asking for an injunction that the exchange, that is the sacred site goes to the mining company, and the Forest Service gets like 5 tracts of land that Rio Tinto has bought. Anyway, they said back in June, no, we can't grant that injunction. the whole panel of judges in the Ninth Circuit said, no, we want to hear that again. And they gave an en banc panel of 11 judges who heard arguments again on that issue back in March. We're still waiting to hear what their decision is going to be. But it was good news that they wanted to hear this again and consider it. Secondly, it looked like the Forest Service was ready to move on with the exchange, publish the impact statement, which means 60 days later the exchange would take place. But there was a mobilization of people who wrote the White House and said, don't let the Secretary of Agriculture and the Forest Service do that. Now, they had said that impact statement was going to be out in spring or summer. Now, it's indefinite. We don't know when it's going to be out. So something worked in the White House from people objecting to this. So finally, what else do I want to say? So judicial things are looking up. And then finally, the new Save Oak Flat from Foreign Mining Act has been reintroduced. It's been introduced the ever since 2014. It has to be reintroduced with every new Congress. Anyway, so the justice team, every once in a while, will come to you either this way or in the newsletter with opportunities to act on things that we believe things need to be acted on. So you have two opportunities today. One is to send a letter to Representative Kathy Manning, who co-sponsored the bill last Congress, but hasn't yet signed on to this bill, though she's been asked by the ministers' conference in town. So we're going to send her a letter from our congregation with our picture from March. So sign this letter today. And then we're also going to send a letter to Winsler Nosey, our friend who has been fighting this for, as I said, 15 years or more. And just to say that we want to convey to you that we hold this struggle and to protect Oak Flat in our hearts and prayers. We stand ready to continue the fight with you to defend the life-giving integrity of this sacred place, integral to the culture and health of your people and the other native peoples, as well as to Mother Earth, and so to us all. This will go to Winsler. We just want to say we're with you. Sometimes it can be discouraging, sometimes encouraging. But anyway, I'll have these out in the narthex after the service. So, and I'll bring them back to the snack time if you don't want to stop here. But please stop before you leave and sign both of these letters. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. We come to our closing song, and while the song is sung, we offer invitation to connect with sacred presence by lighting a candle with an intention, by receiving anointing with oil, by receiving communion. Now, there is a requirement, the only requirement: come hungry, come longing for connection. We trust that Holy Presence is blessing the oil and the kindling of fire and the receiving of bread and cup. Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest. Thank you. Thank you for your presence and your witness. Thank you for hosting and being hosted throughout your days. Thank you for breaking bread with those most intimate and those you are just getting to know. Thank you for being the bread of life for some as you care for yourself and your relationships, and most of all, come before the sacred presence to receive. Go in a just peace. Amen.